want all the men of First Church, want you to come as we offer a prayer for you. All the men, won't you come this way? All the men. As I said, if we have our men, if they're committed and dedicated, we know that our church will be stronger. Our homes will be stronger. Our communities will be stronger. Amen. Come on, give God some praise to all these men. Bunch of good-looking men, too. Amen. Amen. Let's look to the Lord. God, on this day, we thank you for fathers and we thank you for men. We thank you, oh God, for their commitment to you. We pray today, God, that they would renew their commitments and that they would redouble their efforts, that they would rededicate themselves to be more faithful in their service, to be more faithful in their work, in their worship, in their witness. Because we know, God, that stronger homes, stronger communities, stronger churches are a result of men who are committed to serving and pleasing you. And so we pray, God, that you would touch them in a special way, that you would anoint them from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet, that you, God, would pour out your spirit on each one of them that makes serving easy, makes witnessing easy, that they would know that it's not by their power nor by their might, but it's by your spirit. Allow them to rely on you. Allow them to continue to resist the devil and know that he will flee. Allow them to rest on your word, rest in your promise. Bless them, strengthen them, keep them is our prayer. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Amen, amen. Give the Lord a hand of praise. I pray for you and you pray for me. And how many of you know we can watch God change things? I mean, somebody turn to your neighbor and say, you pray for me, I'll pray for you. And together, we'll watch God change things. Somebody here knows what I'm talking about. You prayed for somebody for the problems they were having on their job. They prayed for you for the problems you were having in your home. And both of you can celebrate because you've been able to watch God change things. Amen. Let's give God another praise, hand of praise for this choir. Certainly, let me say what a deep delight and a rich joy it is to greet this great congregation on this morning. And certainly to Reverend O'Connor, my friend and my brother, I am honored by the invitation to be here and to share with you. and you have welcomed me warmly. I feel like I'm at home today. Amen. Now, I know some of you heard that I was a Baptist preacher, and you said, just don't feel like you're in a Baptist church, because we've got to be out of here. We're going to take our fathers to brunch. Amen. 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 But it is a joy and a privilege and a pleasure to be here, and I assure that I greet you today in that name that is above every name, name before which one day every knee is going to have to bow, every tongue is going to have to confess to the glory of God that he is Lord. I wonder if there are just two or three folk that don't mind declaring that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt, he's risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Our scripture has already been read. Simply want to call your attention to the subject, the Spirit-filled life. The Spirit-filled life. We're almost halfway through the year 2015. And if truth be told, we have been faced with many challenges this year. In fact, many of us were challenged on Wednesday night when we learned of the horrific tragedy in Charleston, South Carolina. And so, not only that challenge, but we've been challenged in so many ways this year. And on this morning, I want to encourage us all, but especially on this Father's Day, I want to encourage and to challenge the fathers, the men of this great church. I want to challenge you and to encourage you to be more faithful. Amen? More faithful in your devotion, more faithful in your dedication. I want to challenge you to be more faithful in your attendance, more faithful in your actions, more faithful in your attitude, more faithful in your prayer life, more faithful in the service you render unto our Lord, more faithful in your study, more faithful in your stewardship. I want to challenge you to be more faithful in your walk, in your talk, in your worship, and in your witness. And I say I want to challenge all of us, but I want to challenge men and fathers in particular, because if we want our communities to be stronger, we need men to be more faithful. If we want our homes to be stronger, we need men to be more faithful. And yes, even if we want our church to be stronger, we need men to be more faithful. And so I challenge and charge you this morning to be more faithful. And in order to be more faithful, we've got to realize that we cannot do it on our own. In order to be more faithful, we've got to realize that we must rely on the sovereignty of God. And so I want us to make up in our mind right now, whatever we go through, we're going to rely on the sovereignty of God and know that it's working out for our good. We've got to resist the urge to succumb to our surroundings. You don't have to be a product of your environment. Faithfulness requires that we withstand whatever pressures are brought to bear on us by our surroundings. And I also want you to remember that God always honors and rewards faithfulness. And so today, I want to challenge you to live a Spirit-filled life, a Spirit-filled life that will empower you and enable you to be more faithful. Someone may be asking, what does it mean to live a Spirit-filled life? Well, that's a good question. I'm glad you asked. It's an appropriate question. But maybe the more appropriate question is, what does it mean to be filled with the Spirit in the first place? The filling, the controlling of the Holy Spirit is a profound reality in the life of every believer. And we must come to understand that it can change our lives. You remember Jesus was filled with the Spirit when he was led into the wilderness to be tempted of Satan. And the Bible records it changed his life. The disciples were filled with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost when Peter stood up and preached a sermon and 3,000 folk were saved and joined the church, and it changed their lives. The first deacons were filled with the Holy Spirit. Even Stephen was full of the Holy Spirit when he was stoned to death. And the Bible declares that he saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God, and it changed his life. Barnabas and Saul, before he was converted to Paul, were filled with the Holy Spirit. And I wonder if there's anybody here who wants to live a spirit-filled life. Anybody here who wants to be more faithful, more committed, wants the Spirit to change your life. Well, I call your attention then to Paul's words in the fifth chapter of his letter to the church at Ephesus. And we're not surprised when we read of Paul's epistle to the Ephesians, particularly in the 18th verse, where he exhorted them, "And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit." Eugene Peterson, in his translation, The Message, he translates that verse like this: "Don't drink too much wine. That cheapens your life. Drink the Spirit of God, huge drafts of it." Now, by exegetical and textual examination, it teaches us, in order to allow the Spirit to change our lives, in order for us to be filled, the first thing we need to see and recognize in the text is that God commands us to live Spirit-filled lives. God, the omniscient one, God, the all-knowing one, knew that some folk he would need to make a distinction because of the reality is that some of us are controlled by, some of us are filled with, and some of us are led by the wrong spirit. That there are a whole lot of spirits out there, and even in Ephesus, Paul needed to make the distinction because those who worship pagan gods, those who had pagan worship rituals, they worshiped a god named Bacchus, the god of wine and drunkenness. And they believed that in order to commune with their god and to be led by their god, they had to be drunk. In their drunken state, they could determine, they thought, the will of their god and determine how best to serve and obey him. You ever wonder why drunk people love to debate about God? That's why Paul the Apostle said there is a distinction between being drunk with wine and being drunk and filled with the Spirit. There's a distinction between Spirit's wine and the Holy Spirit. There's a difference between Boone's Farm and the Holy Spirit. There's a difference between Wild Iris Rose and the Holy Spirit. There's a difference between Mad Dog 2020 and the Holy Spirit. There's a difference between, I haven't hit your drink yet. There's a difference between Moscato and the Holy Spirit. There's a difference between Vanique and the Holy Spirit. There's a difference between Nicki Minaj's mix and the Holy Spirit. And the distinction is made because there is a difference in being turned up because you are full of wine and being turned up because you are full of the Holy Spirit. Be not drunk with wine, which is in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. There is a distinction made to teach us how to commune with the God of heaven. There's a distinction made to teach us how to live for him, how to serve and to obey him, and how to determine his will for our lives. But the text also suggests that while there is a distinction, there are also some similarities between being filled with too much wine and being filled with the Holy Spirit. Some similarities to being intoxicated with alcohol and being intoxicated with the Almighty. Let me see if I can explain. Have you ever been around someone who had too much to drink? Hold on. I don't want you to be gossiping. So let me try this another way. Do you remember a time when you had too much to drink? Do you remember how brave you suddenly got? How happy you were? How turn up you were? How talkative you were? How generous you were? how it did you didn't have a care in the world. Well, similarly, when you are full with the Holy Spirit, you're brave because you realize that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and a sound mind. You're happy because you realize that the joy that you have, the world didn't give it, and the world can't take it away. Similarly, you don't have a care in the world because you've come to realize if you seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, then all of these other things will be added unto you. So you don't have to worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. But each day you rely on God to be your provider. Let me also suggest that the text teaches us that some folk may treat this command as if it's optional, like it's a suggestion, be filled with the Holy Spirit. This is not a suggestion. This is not a request. But for every born-again believer, this is a command. In fact, the verb is in the imperative mode. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. God commands each believer to live a spirit-filled life. And in order to live a spirit-filled life, you must be filled with the Holy Spirit. And you need to know that being continually filled with the Holy Spirit is not an option. It's a biblical mandate. The verb is also in the present tense, which indicates that it is an ongoing command. In other words, the command is to live a spirit-filled life. You must continually be filled with the Holy Spirit. Well, what does it mean to be continually filled? To be continually in contact. It reminds me of persons. You could always tell who were the winos in the town that I grew up in, because the person always kept their source or their supply in close proximity. In fact, if you just looked in their back pocket, you could see a pint of whatever their favorite drink was. Similarly, the same way, we need to stay close to the source. We need to stay close to our supply. We need to stay close to Jesus so that the Spirit can continually fill us. Minute by minute, hour by hour, day by day, week after week, month after month, year after year, in order for us to live a Spirit-filled life, God commands that we be continually filled so that we can be controlled by the Spirit. Man's law teaches us that you cannot operate a motor vehicle when you have consumed too much wine. You may lose control and cause a casualty. But God's law says that you cannot operate in your gift, your calling, your ministry, your purpose until you have been consumed and controlled by the Holy Spirit. You don't mind if I give you an example of that, do you? Do remember that Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit when he was led up by the Spirit in the wilderness to be tempted? He was able to resist the devil because he simply told the devil, "It is written, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God." You will recall he said, "Do not put the Lord your God to a test." You recall he said, "Get behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord God, and him only shalt thou serve." My Bible says that the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. Simply because he was controlled and consumed by the Spirit, he was able to resist the devil. And that's why I keep trying to tell you that in order to live a Spirit-filled life, God commands that we constantly, moment by moment, be controlled by the Holy Spirit. Being constantly, continually filled with the Spirit that leads us and guides us through life's trials, the Spirit that empowers us, the Spirit that strengthens us, the Spirit that enables us to do that spiritually, which we could never do on our own physically. The Spirit that gives us victory. And we need to be reminded that our victories are not by our power nor by our might, but they are by the Spirit, says the Lord. And so my question to you to consider this morning, are you constantly being filled? Does the Spirit of God control you, lead you, guide you moment by moment? Are you walking in the Spirit moment by moment in this lifetime? Are you being dependent upon the Holy Spirit? Are you living the Spirit-filled life? That's why the songwriter asked the question, is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your heart does the Spirit control? He declared you can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as you yield him your body and your soul. God commands us to live Spirit-filled lives. Secondly, our commitment to God requires that we live Spirit-filled lives. Every believer has a tremendous responsibility and obligation that must be fulfilled. God has called each one of us to do something unique. God has gifted each one of us to do something unique, to be a blessing to the kingdom and the communities in which we serve. And in order to do so, we have to live Spirit-filled lives. We'll never be able to experience the intimacy with God and enjoy all that God has for us if we fail to live Spirit-filled lives. In fact, Romans 8 and 5 reminds us, those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. Our commitment to God requires that we please God. There are three kinds of lifestyles. Self-centered people, that's oftentimes the life that you live before you receive Christ. That's when you sit on your own throne. You make your own decisions. You live your life for yourself. You seek to please yourself. Self is on the throne, and God and Christ are often somewhere in the periphery of your life. There's the Christ-centered life. After receiving Christ, you relinquish your throne to the one who really is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You live for Christ. You seek to please Christ. You declare, as Paul declared, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. You live in the Spirit. You have the ability to live a life that is pleasing to God because you are consumed and controlled by the Spirit. You're trying to please God in your walk, in your talk, in your worship, in your witness, and in your work. But perhaps the saddest lifestyle is the lifestyle of a self-centered Christian. The person who has received Christ but has not committed themselves to live a spiritual life. The one who has not yielded, not surrendered. The one who is spiritually immature. The one who Paul describes as a babe in Christ. You remember Paul says that there are some folk who would rather be conformed to this world than have their minds, have their lives changed by the renewing of their minds. You remember Paul told the people at Corinth that he could not speak to them unto them as spiritual, but he had to speak to them as carnal, even as babes in Christ. He wanted to give them the meat of the word, but because of their carnality, their immaturity, the only thing that he could give them was the milk of the word. Our commitment to God requires us to live Spirit-filled lives. Our commitment to God requires us to rely on the Spirit, not to put our trust in man, not to put our hopes in man, not to even trust in ourselves, but as the songwriter said, on Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. People who trust in their own efforts, their own strength to live a Christian life, will inevitably experience a life filled with failure, fraught, and frustration, just as those who live to please themselves rather than God. But living a spirit-filled life means that we recognize that we are co-laborers with God. God is always at work, and God has called us, commissioned us, even commanded us to be his co-laborers. That's why in verse 15, it's God's reminder to each of us that we ought to make use of time and opportunity wisely. Think of all the ministry opportunities we can let slip through our fingers if we're not controlled and led by the Spirit. While we as Christians should want to be filled with the Spirit to have power for serving and working and worshiping and ministering, the unfortunate truth and the harsh reality is far too often Christians want to be filled with the Spirit so that they can please themselves, so that they can have a flowery bed of ease. They see the Spirit fill life as a source of enjoyment rather than a source of empowerment to serve God, a source of playing rather than a source of praying, a source of seeking rather than a source of serving, a source of wavering rather than a source of witnessing. I don't know how you feel about it this morning, but my Bible tells me, ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be my witnesses. In the last instance, if we live a spirit-filled life, it requires us, it commands us to turn ourselves and everything over to God. I don't know about you, but bad bumper sticker theology gets to me sometimes. How many of you seen the bumper sticker that says, God is my co-pilot? That's the problem. God is in the co-pilot seat when God needs to be in the pilot seat. It reminds me of this gripping story of an air tragedy that happened in Fort Worth, Texas. A young student wanting to be a pilot was making one of his final training flights. And evidently, for some unknown reason, he froze at the controls. And his instructor began to yell, "Turn over the controls to me. Turn over the controls to me." But frightened and frozen, the student didn't turn the controls over. And tragically, both were killed in an airplane crash. Tragedy can occur when those of us who are in spiritual training don't turn the controls over to our wise instructor known as the Holy Spirit. Turn over the controls so that we will be filled. Not solely, being filled was not solely reserved for the disciples on the day of Pentecost, but it is the promise to every believer: you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost has come upon you. The Spirit-filled life is a life of complete surrender to God's control. And as a result of that, the promise is that if we turn our lives over, we will produce spiritual fruit. And somebody knows that you can know a tree by the fruit that it produces. And so when we turn our lives over, when we commit ourselves today to live the Spirit-filled life, we'll be able to speak and to encourage ourselves. We'll be able to speak truth to power as Peter did on the day of Pentecost. When we are led by the Spirit, we'll be able to say like Stephen said when he was stoned. We'll be able to sing in the choir together in unity and in harmony and say that I know that I can make it. I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in his hands. The Spirit-filled life is a life of complete surrender. Not our will, but thy will be done. My challenge to you today, my charge to you today, is live a spirit-filled life. Amen.